Hi, everyone, and thank you so much. Really, thank you so much for joining us today. I really appreciate it both personally and on behalf of the coalition. I'm just getting my paperwork together. Excuse me. There we go. I think we're on Zoom. We're open on Zoom too, right? So, and thank everyone who's joining us remotely as well. This is our first time, if you can't tell, doing it hybrid, so I'm a little bit confused. I just want to first thank our supporters, our grant hosts, 1199 SEIU, United Healthcare Workers East, AARP New York, Daly and Marino LLP, Dignity Alliance of Massachusetts, Sherburn Electronics Incorporated, and the law firm of DF Trahowski. Those are our grant hosts. Our benefactors for the program are Joan Burke, and Joan is here today. Hi, Joan. National Consumer Voice for Quality Long-Term Care, www.essentialcarevisitor.com, Thomas Gallivan, Jeanette Sandor, whose snack I tipped over before. Jeanette, I hope I didn't get it on you. The Risotto Law Firm, excuse me, and the Schenck Law Firm. And then our individual sponsors, Margaret Coppola, Christine Crowley, Richard Danford, Mary Ellen Delafield, Elizabeth Halifax, the steering committee of some of my favorite people, the family council at the New York State Veterans Home at Montrose, Teresa Norbaum, Lisa Pincus, John Rodat with Public Signals, and Peter Wish. I also want to thank our board members, Deb, Jeanette, Joan, Jeff, Mary Ellen, Marion, and Martin for their work for this program, and of course, all their support for the organizations. And I want to thank Anita and Haley and Latanya and Sarah, who may be in or out, for all the work they did to make this possible. Last but certainly not least, before we get on with the program, I want to dedicate it to memory of a dear friend of ours, Joel Rosenberg. Joel would come every single year to help his wife, Sarah, greet people, to make sure that everyone was taken care of. When I was looking for a picture of Joel to include today, I went through years of emails from Sarah that had an attachment on them to see if I could find a picture that I liked. And so many times Joel was supporting us completely as a volunteer, going to the bank for Sarah and for us, proofing materials for us, et cetera. He's one of the nicest people that I've ever met. And Joel and Sarah are two of the nicest people that I've ever met. And as I said to Sarah a couple of days ago, I honestly didn't know the meaning of the expression, may one's memory always be a blessing, until Joel died. And I truly feel that way. And we'll miss him very much, but wanted to dedicate today to him. Thank you. Thank you. He was just a wonderful, wonderful, bright person, and I'll truly miss him. So we're going to have our panel now, and we have our, sorry, I'm a little bit, feeling a little bit emotional about that, but we have our Amy Sheffrin here, and Amy Sheffrin will be moderating the panel. Amy is the principal and founder of Shared Purpose Partners, an independent consulting firm. I know Amy from when she worked for the New York State Health Foundation. She was our first program officer there. And I always found Amy to be just incredibly intelligent and interested and dedicated to doing good. And so she was the person that I thought of to be the moderator for this program. And I'm so happy that she accepted. We have three wonderful panelists. Unfortunately, one of our panelists had to was unable to make it because of a urgent family matter. So our three panelists that are joining us today are Lori Smetanka. Lori is the executive director of the National Consumer Voice for Quality Long-Term Care. She is just an incredibly intelligent and thoughtful advocate. I'm so glad that she's going to be joining us today. And I should also say personally that I think of Lori every single day when I do Wordle, because Lori is the only person I know who did Wordle in the first round of guessing. Yes. And I've done Wordle, at least attempted it every day for a long time. And I've never gotten, occasionally I get two if I'm very lucky. Susan Lynch is also joining us today. Susan is Senior Counsel for Elder Justice at the United States Department of Justice, where she leads national investigations and civil prosecutions on long-term care facilities that fail to adequately care for their residents. Susan is just an incredible, really a dynamo intellectually and in terms of energy, working to improve nursing home care in this country. And I'm just so grateful that she is here with us today. And I should add that she also ran the Boston Marathon yesterday. So I'm personally appreciative that she was able to come today. And last but certainly not least is Dr. Jonathan Evans. Dr. Evans is a geriatrician and dementia care expert who has focused most of his career on understanding Alzheimer's disease, and non-Alzheimer's dementia, how it affects individuals and family, and decoding the so-called behaviors that people living with dementia often express. And I see Jed nodding his head. I mean, Dr. Evans has just been one of the most, if not the most thoughtful practitioners that I've ever met in talking about dementia care and getting dementia care and really helping others to understand what dementia care should look like and how to best meet the needs of individuals who have dementia. So I'm really thrilled to have our panelists here. And I thank you very much for coming, both remotely and in person.
Thank you, Richard. Hi, everyone. It's great to meet you. I have to say, there's something about the energy in this room. It's a, you know, it's not the largest reception, but there's something about being in community and feeling the solidarity of people who care about the same issues you do. And I definitely feel it in the room and talking to people in conversations just at this reception. People have been very open about their lives and how their lives have been touched by nursing home care or LTCCC. So I just want to say again, I'm Amy Sheffrin. I'm honored to be moderating this panel on a topic dear to my heart for an organization like LTCC that has been a leading voice for all of us. We all want nursing homes to be the best source of care for our loved ones and for ourselves, for myself. And everyone on this panel for us sees the full promise of nursing homes, the reforms needed, and the communities they can be. So I hope you are also hopeful about the possibilities for change and join me in welcoming our panel. And I'm going, this is my first time moderating a panel where people are not, are all remote. So in terms of I'll be asking some questions and then we'll set aside some time at the end for Q&A for people who are on the Zoom to post questions remotely. We'll see your questions in the Q&A and for people in the audience to ask questions at the end. But in terms of being able to our panelists, I'm just going to say they can, we can go in the order that Richard introduced them, Lori, Susan, and Jonathan, as I ask the questions, if that makes it easier for everyone on the panel to know when to hop in with their answer. And can we see all of our panelists?
No, we're not able to turn our cameras on.
Okay, but are all the panelists on audio?
Yes.
Yes. Can you hear us, Amy?
Yes, we can all hear you. So,
okay.
Jonathan, you are as well?
Yes.
Okay, great. So then to make it easier, we can just go in the order as we go for the questions, because I want to try to make it as easy as possible for the panelists to answer the questions. And I'll kick it off with the first question, which is just what brought you to work in this area? Share a little bit about your work, what brought each of you to this work? And if you have it, please include, is there a story that drives your work, some story that really touched you that helps you keep going in this area? So in the order that we stated, we could go Lori, Susan, then Jonathan. Thank you.
Hi, this is Lori, and thanks for having me with you all today. It's really a pleasure to be here. It was a real fluke that I got the one turn Wordle, Richard. So because I play the same word every day, and of course it had to come up once, right? And it did. So now I've had to change my start word. But it's just a great pleasure to be with all of you. So I got into this work. I came actually to the Consumer Voice, formerly called Nickner, right after law school. I was job searching. I had the opportunity to get referred to the work that was being done at Nickner by a professor of mine, and knew I was looking to get into working on public policy issues, and had a real interest in long-term care and healthcare issues, and was connected with Consumer Voice. And when I came, you know, it just fit for me. It was, it felt like, you know, a real opportunity to work on things that I found to be really important, and with a lot of great people. And, you know, at that time, Elma Holder, who was the founder of our organization, was the executive director, and Sarah Berger and Jackie Koenig, and, you know, others who have been just giants in the field were running the organization, and were very welcoming and really impressed upon me the importance of the work that was being done. But I think, like many of us who have gotten into this work, we have a connection with people who are older, who've needed long-term care, some of whom have had bad experiences. Fortunately, I didn't, but I had grandparents with Alzheimer's disease and dementia who did live in long-term care facilities at some point through their lives, some, you know, after I had been in this field for quite a while, and was very close to them and always wanted the best for them. And so, you know, meshing my personal connection with the people who I was very close to, along with the interesting work and the passionate work that was done at the Consumer Voice or Nickner at the time, is what got me into this field. Susan, I'll pass on to you.
Well, thank you, Lori. Thank you, Richard, for the introduction and for including me in this discussion today. Mm-hmm. Nursing home quality is an absolutely critical issue, and it looks like we're going to be able to join you visually.
Yes.
Oh, there we go. Hello, everyone.
Thank
you again. And so my why. So why did I get into this work? Well, it started, I grew up in Fall River, Mass, which is a southeastern part of Massachusetts, formerly an old mill town. And it is, you know, a somewhat economically challenged area. And my dad, my grandmother on my father's side, was in a nursing home. And I can remember being, you know, 6 or 7 years old and going with him to the nursing home. And he was never really happy, I think, that his mom, my grandmother, was in that nursing home. And it wasn't the kind of place I think that we'd want our loved ones to be. So that had an impression on me. And then being with my parents as they aged, and my mother had Alzheimer's, and all the challenges we faced in finding and selecting a quality long-term care solution for them, and really helping them navigate that, you know, was a pretty powerful experience. When I got to the Department of Justice, not originally intending only to do the nursing home work, but I had the opportunity to do some long-term care quality cases, and some of what I saw in large numbers occurring in nursing homes and terrible quality conditions really led me to believe that this was my calling. You know, and in addition to prosecuting nursing homes, I think the other piece of it is really trying to bring together coalitions of people like ourselves to improve things and to get in there and make policy and do preventative work before we end up with the prosecution. Because, you know, while these cases are important, when you get to the point of prosecuting, a lot of people have suffered. So that's how I got into this work. And it's great to be with you tonight.
I guess it's my, can you hear me okay? This is Jonathan. It's good to see everybody. And I'm really incredibly honored and delighted to be here, especially with such an awesome panel of people I admire and love very much. I'll try to be uncharacteristically brief, but I'll tell you a quick story. But basically, I had the good fortune of being surrounded by older people when I was a child who loved me unconditionally and encouraged me beyond my own sort of expectations of myself. I really didn't expect to be, when I went to medical school, I didn't necessarily expect to be working in long-term care settings, although I had spent, especially since I spent a fair amount of time in one as a kid. My great grandmother was still alive when I was a child. She lived to be well over 100. And my mother was sort of responsible for overseeing her care. And so she, as a young child, I spent a lot of time there. And it was a very disturbing and scary place for a young child. And one of the things that was most vivid was the smell, which was not any human smell. It was probably carbolic acid, which was the disinfectant of the day. And then the people that were there, that lived there, were like flotsam and jetsam adrift on the sea. It was very confusing to me, because even though people were in human form, they were not very responsive. And it seemed like some sort of purgatory. And frankly, it took me many years to discover that the reason for that was that almost to a person, they were being chemically restrained. I went to medical school, encouraged by my grandparents in particular. And early on, I met a physician who was a mentor of mine, a man named Daryl Chutka, because I didn't really, there were no physicians in my family. But the story I wanted to tell you was basically the first day that I worked in a nursing home as a doctor. And this story was around a little after 1990. So in other words, this was right after the OBRA 87 regulations came fully into effect. And essentially, I was in residency training. I was about to start a geriatric fellowship, and I was given this moonlighting job as sort of a ward almost, really. That blurriness, by the way, is me. I'm naturally blurry. I saw there was a comment about the blurriness on the panel, but I'll try to work on my camera here. I apologize. Basically, so what happened was, as you probably, many of you are familiar, the OBRA regulations really made a huge impact on trying to improve the quality of care, and as well as the rights of people living in nursing homes. And I'll just tell you, there's nothing in my 35 plus year career that I've seen that has done more to improve the quality of care than those regulations. But having said that, one of the requirements was that everybody that lived in a nursing home had to be seen by a physician periodically. And the large medical center where I worked thought these regulations were ridiculous. And so they decided they would comply with the letter of the regulations, but not the spirit, by simply counting every visit, including an eye doctor visit out in a clinic, as a nursing home visit. And so I was hired essentially as a to go make recertification visits, which I had no idea what they were. But the only instruction I was given was that this was to make sure that the nursing home wasn't ripping off the government by billing for dead people or something like that. And I was told specifically, now, these aren't actually your patients, and so don't actually take care of them, because your malpractice might not cover that. And so very briefly, that was my admonition. And I was supposed to write four sentences on each little note, if you will, two or three of which had already been written before I showed up. And so anyway, I was sitting at the desk trying to focus on this task at hand, and I could hear this sound from a distance. This is basically a nursing station with four corridors in each direction. I will promise not to answer other questions, just to save time. I apologize. But basically, I heard this sound in the distance, and it was this repetitive sound. I was like, I didn't know what it was. It was a little bit distracting. After a while, I realized someone was actually yelling help, okay? And I saw, I could tell the direction the sound was coming from, and people were walking past seemingly oblivious. And basically I was trying to focus on my task at hand, but I could hear my mother and grandmother in my head saying, "We didn't put you through medical school so you could be such a jerk," you know? And so I decided then and there, okay, if somebody needs help, I'm gonna help them, you know? And I went charging after this sound, and I got closer and closer, and it was coming from a particular room, and the door was open a crack. And I'd been, you know, a doctor long enough to have seen in the hospital and elsewhere that, you know, sometimes people would fall and they'd be behind a door. So I pushed it open just very gently. And to my, and I could hear the sound. It was basically, "Help, help, help." And when I opened the door to my, there was a woman sitting in a, essentially a, restrained in a Jerry chair, just with her eyes closed. And she was just saying, "Help, help." And I didn't know what that was. I hadn't been trained for that, but I thought, well, you know, I better figure out what's going on. So I tapped her on the shoulder, and she had this big startle reflex, which sometimes happens with certain forms of dementia. And she looked at me with this troubled look, and she said, "Are you a nurse?" And I said, "Oh no, I'm a doctor." And she said, "Help, help, help." And she was screaming at the top of her lungs. And I thought, there's only one rule and I've already broken it. And so basically I ran out of there, went back to my spot. I hoped that nobody saw me, and I just kept my head down the rest of the time. And it was many years later, even still after my training, that I really understood what was going on there, which is something I'd be happy to talk about. So I apologize for that long-winded story, but I was inspired by, well, just I got caught up in the excitement of the moment. So thank you.
That was a great story, and you cannot volunteer yourself not to answer future questions. So okay. I'm sorry. And it really took me back, because for everyone who's been in a nursing home, we have all heard that echo of someone saying help. And there's something very human about that, that that's the call that we have all heard. So my next question is, what do you all feel hopeful about? You all approach this from different perspectives, particularly DOJ or consumer voice or as a doctor. What do you feel hopeful about? And, you know, to that, are there reforms you want to see? Are there opportunities that you see happening with a new generation of advocates? Anything you want to speak to that's hopeful? Thank you.
Sure. So, you know, I think one of the things I feel most hopeful about is that there are a lot of good, smart, motivated, and caring people who are advocating in this area, you know, and I mean, again, you know, my co-panelists and Richard and Haley and, you know, so many of you that I see your names in the chats, that, you know, and that there has been such dedication to and focused energy on looking at how to improve quality in nursing homes. I think that's something that I'm most hopeful about, you know, when there are days when it's just hard to find things to latch onto. And that's, you know, happened a lot, you know, through the years. You know, I think most recently, another thing that I have been, you know, hopeful about is that there does seem to be increased, maybe not recognition, but maybe validation that the things we've been advocating for the last 50 years with respect to the work being done at NICNR, Consumer Voice, is really needed. And that, you know, we're on the right side of history, and that, you know, we're really doing whatever it takes to try to improve the daily lives of people. I mean, we hear a lot from, you know, residents and family members and others who, you know, constantly comment, you know, "Thank you for the work that you're doing and how important it is." And I think that's true for, you know, for so many of us. But, you know, we've talked a lot over the last couple of years, particularly with respect to the list of nursing home reforms that President Biden had issued 2 years ago. And we all talked about how we could have written that list and, you know, how validating that was. And even the National Academy's report that came out, you know, shortly after, again, you know, the findings validated the work that we do. And so, you know, the fact that I think that we're on the right track in terms of what we're pushing and advocating for, I think, you know, definitely is really helpful. You know, I do think in terms of, you know, the fact that we are seeing increased engagement from family members, you know, unfortunately, so much of that happened as a result of what occurred during the pandemic. But the fact that, you know, there are a number of family members who really have taken up the mantle beyond just what some of the issues that, you know, arose during the pandemic showed, but are kind of in it for the long haul. You know, that's been really validating too, and hopeful in terms of thinking, you know, how that we could really expand the network of people that are actively working on and engaging these issues. And I think the fact that there does seem to be a lot of momentum to address the poor quality that we're seeing. I'm having to, you know, kind of pin some hope on that right now as well, that there does seem to be interest, momentum with respect to, you know, policies that are being promoted both at the state and the national level. And again, the fact that there are a lot of people, excuse me, rallying around these issues. So I'll stop there and pass it on to my co-panelists, and maybe we can have continued conversation.
Thank you, Lori. So I'll focus on four areas that I'm hopeful about. I guess the first is the coalition building that has occurred with everyone really pushing nursing home reform. And by that, I mean federal, state, and local partnerships that are really you know, substantial in the work that I do with the department. We work with our Medicaid fraud control units. We work with our state ombudsman, which Lori has been instrumental in helping with, and bringing in other key partners to this work, right? I mean, we all hear it takes a village, but to bring these cases to do this work, emergency medical services, law enforcement, the department just did a big summit on that. And with all of us engaged as nursing homes being a top priority and trying to put as many resources as we possibly can behind it, I think, you know, we've begun an excellent coordination. So I'm very hopeful about that. To really echo what Lori was saying, you know, the policies are being addressed in the areas that are critical. Staffing is absolutely critical. And we've seen a lot come out on staffing, and I'm sure there's debate on both sides, but we are addressing that critical issue. Transparency of ownership and cost reports. I know that Richard and Lori and many others on this call have been very focused on that. And obviously, you know, we can't really try to do enforcement against owners. We don't know who they are. So having that transparency is critical. And also seeing an interest in some cultural competency in nursing homes across the board. So I think that's also super important as well. On the next generation, so obviously here we not only have an opportunity but an obligation to really bring in new people. And I think there is an interest in some of the younger generations, if I may say, in intergenerational solutions. And I think that's really critical where we can work in the community together. I think secondly, some of the really critical issues that the younger folks are interested in, like equity, like homelessness and housing and fairness, those are all things that bear directly on nursing homes. And so to the extent that younger folks are really focused on those issues, I think that we, you know, have a lot of good people to bring. And then the fourth is really, you know, as you said, Lori, the human element. So I think there's a lot of commitment now, certainly by Consumer Voice, to bring the voice of residents during your conferences, but just all across the board to bring the residents to the forefront. And I think ultimately, you know, every movement needs a champion, and the residents are really the champion there. And that's been super effective. So all very hopeful things. And with that, I'll pass it over to Jonathan. Oh, Jonathan, I think you're on mute.
Yeah, I apologize. I was just saying that I have many, many concerns about healthcare, but I won't talk about that at the moment. But notwithstanding those concerns, I am also still, I'm very hopeful about the future in a lot of ways. And I'll elaborate on that. First off, there's never been a better time in the history of the world to do good than right now, because there's never been a greater need. So the opportunity is there. I'm encouraged by the many people that I meet of all ages whom God made to love and care for other people. And even in some of the worst nursing homes I've ever set foot in, I've encountered some very saintly people who are staying there because of the residents that they love. So, and the other thing that gives me a lot of hope for the future is I've seen what good care looks like, and I've seen it in some unlikely places, not necessarily in beautiful buildings. But what I would say is that about that is when you see what's possible, it makes oftentimes makes what is unacceptable as it should be. But this is a culture in healthcare where, you know, with a sort of apprenticeship tradition of training at all levels, where people only see what is and has been, and it makes everything else impossible. So there are, that's the challenge. But it's hard to know where, if you can't see where you're going, it's hard to get there. And there are so in terms of education and, you know, resources to do things the right way, CMS has provided a ton of that. Consumer Voice is really the go-to clearinghouse for all that information. So there's for people where there's a will, there is a ton of help and resource to help people do that. I would say that, you know, many of the obstacles that surround us in long-term care are very easy to overcome. I'm very concerned about staffing, but what I will say in the positive sense is that even though if you just look at the demographics, as the baby boom generation ages, the number of paid or healthcare workers to provide care for them just simply won't be enough. So it's not a problem that we can buy our way out of, even in hospitals, okay? However, what that means is that there will be more involvement of necessity of family and friends, which means there will be more community, there will be more advocates, there won't be more people, speaking out, and there will be more sunshine. As Justice Brandeis said, there's no disinfectant like sunshine. And so, there's a lot to be hopeful for, and I'm encouraged by the steady stream of people who want to do a good job, who have that mission. The one thing I would say is we can't just rely on saintly people magically showing up. We have to make it easy and convenient for people to do the right thing, and difficult and inconvenient to do the wrong thing.
And if I could, I think that, you know, what Jonathan and Susan, you know, certainly said, it was so important, and looking at how we can continue to engage people. I mean, that's really been, I think, a key factor is having engagement at all levels, and certainly, you know, engaging families, helping residents to raise their voices and making that possible. Technology has made that easier in many respects, in terms of, you know, helping people to raise their voices. And so we certainly need to be looking at how we can continue to do that. But, you know, we need to be looking at how we can bring more people into this space with us. And, you know, we've had great interns over the years, and not only the intergenerational programs that Susan's talking about, but I think looking at how we can engage the schools and the training programs to really encourage people to get involved in this space is really going to be critical.
Thank you. Lori, I'm so glad you added to that point about technology, being able to give a platform for people to raise their voice. The next question is just, what do you think are the biggest challenges? I'm sure we can all spend all day on this. And also with an election looming, there's a lot of different directions you can go, but, you know, what are the challenges you see? And either is it at the challenges at the nursing home level, at the ownership level, at the state level, at the federal level? I was struck by something, Susan, you had said in a call that we had had earlier about, I think it was Susan and not Lori, but had said something about nursing home defense counsel feel more emboldened. And so I think that you had struck me with that and how it does feel like maybe there's a shift now and it's harder to get improvement. So if all of you can speak to the challenges, thank you.
Sure. I think you're right. I think that there are, you know, a number of challenges that we need to overcome. I mean, I think a big part of it is political will to really enforce the standards that we have available to us. We talk a lot about, you know, how good, and Jonathan mentioned this, you know, how good the standards are that we have. The nursing home reform law was groundbreaking and really did, I think, change the way we talk about what care is supposed to look like in a nursing home. And we just need it enforced, right? We just need to try true enforcement. And I just don't think that that's actually happened in a meaningful way. And so, we really need to see that, and there needs to be political will to do that. I think the polarization of politics that we've seen getting worse and worse through the years has made it difficult to get many meaningful changes done, particularly at the federal level. We see a lot more innovative work happening at the state level with respect to policies. It's been very difficult at the federal level to do that. I think money to support advocacy and to promote the implementation of good policies, you know, certainly has been a real issue. You know, when, you know, we sometimes, you know, feel like we're in David and Goliath scenarios when, you know, the nursing home industry has a lot of resources and people and supports to be putting towards these issues. I mean, I continually am impressed with the work that the advocates that we're able to do, considering the imbalance of resources that we all have available to us. But again, I think, you know, that goes back to the dedication of the people and, you know, looking to support each other and to really do the work that's necessary in order to help effectuate change. But, you know, one thing that I think has been a challenge, and Jonathan alluded to this, there are so many resources and opportunities out there about what it takes to provide good care. We know what good care looks like. We know how to provide it. The information is out there. The training programs are out there. The information is out there in terms of how to do it. And it's really accessible in a meaningful way. And yet the fact that there's a lack of self-accountability by many owners and operators with respect to taking on that ownership of making sure that the people that they have agreed to bring into their nursing home and have committed to take care of, and that they're not providing them with quality care and services, and frankly, even supplies and food and, you know, all of the other things that are so meaningful to residents. The fact that that's not happening is not just a policy issue. It's an issue of self-accountability of the people who have taken on that responsibility and said that we will do this, and they're not doing it. So I think, you know, sometimes we need to force that issue and look at how we can encourage people that are maybe more mission-based to get more into this field, and look at how we can really make it difficult for people who are only in it to make profit in order to do that. And that, I think, has driven a lot of the advocacy that's been happening recently. Susan?
Thank you, Lori. Right, so in terms of challenges, you know, I would start with trends, right? So we know, obviously, many more people are gonna be aging, and we can look at the trends in quality. So one of the biggest challenges are trends that we're seeing in the quality metrics. So if you look, you know, go back, you know, 8 or 9 years and look at the hours per resident day and the staffing question and how they decreased. And certainly, you know, the pandemic not only showed some of the major problems, but also we see how, you know, now that we're moving somewhat, gratefully, out of the pandemic, some of those same problems persist. So we have staffing problems, and we have increases in deficiencies in that time frame. So one of the challenges we have is we have a lot more people coming into you know, nursing homes down the road and haven't yet made some of those systematic changes that will improve the quality. That's number one. I think secondly, and this is, you know, sort of policy, this is priorities, this is a lot of things. all of the players involved having this sense of urgency, you know, the urgency of the now, that we really, really do need to buckle down and focus on these questions at this time. And I think while we've come a long way in terms of, you know, talking about the government side of things and in enforcement with federal, state, and local cooperation and coordination, one challenge is that it isn't so systematic across the board that it doesn't become a little bit, you know, dependent upon relationships among the players, right? So, you know, I have a great relationship with people in a certain mafukus and local departments of health, and making that as systematic as we possibly can across the board, so that, you know, when there's a turnover, whether it be of administration or just simply a position, that those strong, very substantive, clear ways that we're supposed to collaborate, you know, continue on. I think another challenge, which, you know, I think, Jonathan, you raised is something that's positive, is also a challenge, which is, you know, the pressure being placed on caregivers. And what we saw, you know, during the pandemic, and I think, Laura, you highlighted this so well in some of your videos, you know, when families were not going into nursing homes to actually do some of the caregiving, things were really falling apart. And so, you know, again, it's great that, you know, we're going to have more caregivers, but that also, you know, raises some of the challenges that we'll see, you know, with the caregiver issues as well. And I think, you know, resources are always an issue. And so to the extent that, you know, more resources can be put into various levels of enforcement and all of that, I think we'll be in a really great place to be able to, you know, do the enforcement that we really need to do to keep things where they need to be from a quality perspective. So with that, let me turn that over to Jonathan.
You're muted again, Jonathan.
Yeah, I'm at home, and I think it's my refrigerator. Every now and then, there's this horrible noise. It sounds like there's an alien invasion, so I keep putting it on mute. But I apologize. So I'm going to mention a couple things that are kind of depressing first, just sort of general things. Number one, measures of health and healthcare in this country have been declining for a long time. Life expectancy in this country has been declining since before the pandemic. And it isn't, I mean, we have the highest rates of infant and maternal mortality in the developed world. We have a life expectancy that is lower than most developed nations, and overall healthcare quality is well below all developed nations. So there are some serious problems with healthcare that go way beyond nursing homes. And nursing homes are pretty much downstream of a lot of that. There's an incredible shortage of nursing that could easily be of nurses that could easily be solved, except for the fact that schools of nursing aren't really interested in solving it. Most schools of nursing for RNs are trying to churn out. They're in academic medical centers, and they're trying to churn out academic nurses. The complaint is that they don't pay the faculty enough, but the same hospitals are paying agency nurses considerably more than that. So, you know, again, it isn't that there isn't enough money, it's how it's being spent. The United States spends five times more than the next country, Canada, on healthcare per person, and the outcomes are substantially worse. And it's the more that we do, the worse it is. Before Medicare Part D came into existence, there was a lively debate about the harm that would cause when older people could have their medicines paid for, because there was a study at the time that showed that 250,000 people in this country die every year as a result of taking their medications exactly as prescribed. That number is considerably higher than that. It's, you know, now, and prescriptions drugs have more than tripled in the last decade or so. So there are some serious problems with healthcare quality, and I'll just say that the problems we face won't be fixed by the people that created them. The shortage of primary care physicians can't be fixed by medical schools in this country because there aren't enough primary care physicians in this country to teach them. Okay, and even with COVID, you know, the lockdowns and so forth caused a major problem for education of nurses and physicians. So the cohort of people that's graduated or graduating has very limited clinical experience with real patients and so forth. So lots of problems like that. What I would say is the shortage of nurses isn't just because we're not training enough. It's that there have been nurses have been treated badly, basically, by management who believe that care happens by magic, okay? And the same thing happens in nursing homes. When you have venture capital firms and others sucking money out, they just think that magically the care will happen and that they can divert those funds without any consequence at all. It's not, I mean, and they believe that they're doing God's work by somehow limiting unnecessary care and stuff like that. So I'm very concerned about the negative aspects, the demoralizing effects of those things on people trying to do the right thing. What I would say is that a couple other big issues are that if you look at the cost of care for a serious illness like sepsis, 97% of the cost of that illness goes to hospital care. And over the years, hospital care per patient per disease is going up, not down, but the length of stay is getting shorter. So people are being discharged sicker and quicker after they've done every test they can think of. And that leaves a tiny fraction, you know, less than 3% for post-acute care and home health. Okay. And so even if nursing homes got paid nothing, you know, and home health agencies got paid nothing, the amount of savings would be so negligible. So what's happened is there's been a huge shift of a displacement of people away from the most expensive sites of care without reducing the cost, okay, to less expensive sites of care, but the resources to care for them haven't followed. And I would just tell you that with the exception of LPNs, physicians and nurses, RNs, have virtually no training in settings outside of the hospital or clinic until they start taking a job there. And once people start, it's assumed that if you have these initials, you know what you're doing. And so there's really almost no formal on-the-job training. It's simply trial by fire, which contributes, and this is the same for physicians too, it contributes to people doing things the way they saw somebody else doing them, regardless of what's the right thing to do. And the biggest challenge that medical specialties face right now is trying to get their diplomates, you know, a board certified internist or infectious disease or whatever else, urologist, trying to get them to actually not do things wrong that they were taught, okay? And there are lots of organizations that are trying to fix this, but with very limited success. So it's a culture of conformity, and you can tell how old a doctor is by the drugs they prescribe, basically. So because what people are imprinted on, you know, in early in their training is how they function often for the rest of their careers. Even something as basic as hand washing, for which we know there's ample evidence of the importance of that, there's a huge difference and this has been studied and studied and studied. Look at physicians, for example, how infrequently they wash hands, you know, and so it doesn't matter that people know it's like a lot of things like smoking. People know that smoking is not good for you, but lots of people smoke, lots of nurses smoke, okay? And similarly, you know, for almost any, I mean, the tragedy of the universe is we all have our reasons, I guess. So a lot of what I'm talking about are really cultural issues. They're not carved in stone. They could change, but it requires a great deal of leadership. And really, constant dripping wears away the stone, I guess, is what I would say. It just may take thousands of years, but hopefully I'll live to see some of that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Jonathan. You're not as shy as you said you were. Okay. Okay. So we're going to turn it over. Correct.
I didn't say I was shy. I said I talked too much. So I was trying to make up for it, but I haven't succeeded.
We're going to turn it over to the audience and the Q&A on the Zoom. We're going to start with the audience. And there should be, is there someone out there with a microphone? Okay. So we have someone with a microphone. Do you want to get up? Here, come up and people can raise their hand if they have questions and you can bring them the mic. Who in the audience wants to be the brave soul to start with a question? Because we have such amazing panelists. Is that a raised hand? Yes. Did you have a raised hand?
Oh no.
Okay. Does anyone have a question? Or we can start with the Zoom. We'll start with the questions on the Zoom.
Okay, so we have a lot of good questions on Zoom. I'm going to start with the first one in the Q&A from Kay Tyberg. What opportunities and practices can nursing homes utilize in changing the images and caring approach? And I'll leave it up to the panelists to
anyone can take it. We actually have a lot of questions and a short time. So if you want to just respond briefly and we'll get to the next one.
I think one of the biggest things they can do is actually provide good care that is person-centered. And I think, you know, too often when you talk to residents of long-term care facilities, what they talk about is, you know, how they feel being in the nursing home and how they want to just be treated as a person. They want to be treated as anyone else. You know, they want to be respected and treated with dignity and have, you know, their wishes and their goals and their preferences respected. And I think doing that would probably be the best thing that a nursing home can do. And word of mouth travels fast in communities. I think in terms of not only for people who are looking to reside in a long-term care facility, but also people that want to work in a long-term care facility. You know, if you know you're providing good care, and I've heard it before, where the facilities that are providing good care and treat their staff with respect, I think have, you know, better occupancy rates. Staff stay longer. You know, there's not that turnover, and they're places that people want to be and they want to work. And I think that by, you know, focusing in on doing that could really benefit the industry as a whole. Susan or Jonathan, if you want to jump in.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I would echo that. I can tell you that, you know, on the flip side, those facilities and organizations that end up on the other side of the negotiating table or the Department of Justice have oftentimes a lot of witnesses, former employees who talk to us about how, you know, the staffing wasn't what it needed to be. They couldn't do their job because it was a two-person assistant. It was just one person. How they felt so terrible that they couldn't, pass meds in the timely fashion or at all, sometimes pain meds, or that they had to, in some of the worst cases, bring in, supplies themselves. And so obviously that isn't good for the residents, and that isn't, good for encouraging more staff so that you can staff up to the level that's appropriate. So absolutely. I completely agree with everything you said, Lori.
I don't think you can overstate the importance of good staffing. Many of the solutions that are used, like hiring agency staff, it's like cancer. It just makes the problem spread and get worse, because somebody who shows up to a healthcare workplace for one day, for one shift, to do a job, can't possibly do the whole job. The best they can do is possibly dispense medications, but they don't know how to reorder medications, so you're just as likely to run out the next day. They don't know the residents, and so they can't identify changes in condition. And what ends up happening is you have somebody who shows up, who gets paid more than everybody else to do half the job, and the most loyal staff who are there working alongside them get paid less to do their job and this temporary person's job too. And so that mindset really needs to change, because it's very counterproductive. And what the rest of the staff see is that, well, they can afford that. They could afford to pay me more. They just don't want to. Okay. So, ultimately what you need is you need people at the highest level of these organizations to model the behavior that they expect from their employees. Okay. And there has to be an understanding that care does not happen by magic, that the people that you want taking care of your mother are in short supply, basically, and always have been and always will be. Richard, were you going to say something? I just saw a message.
Thanks, Jonathan. Sorry, I'm just going to jump in just because we have a few more questions, and we're running out of time here, but sure, thank you for all of that. Unless we have a question in person here. Anyone? Oh, we have one. Okay. She's going to bring the mic over to you. Thanks.
How do you get the nursing homes to give more therapy to the long-term residents that aren't there just to recover from like a hip fracture or you know, I feel like a lot of residents that go into nursing homes, they're not getting enough therapy. They're being encouraged to stay in the wheelchair. You know, they become contracted. So how do we change that where the long-term residents are getting enough therapy to keep them, you know, able to walk and not be wheelchair bound once they get to a nursing home?
I might just jump in real quick on that one. Well, that's difficult. I mean, there are a couple of things, but basically anytime somebody has lost function from their prior level, they're entitled to, they have the right to get therapies and to improve. So this is a really important fundamental issue. It is complicated. I'll just tell you that the payment for nursing homes, at least on the skilled care side, changed in 2018, which, and the way that this happened, I think actually creates many opportunities for the Justice Department to intervene if necessary. Because basically what happened is there was a shift from paying for minutes of therapy to paying by the diagnosis. But they didn't know how much, CMS didn't know how much to pay per diagnosis. So what they did is they figured out, well, how many therapy minutes did people with that diagnosis get? All right. And as soon as that payment system came into effect, a lot of nursing home companies who had outsourced their therapy to contractors suddenly renegotiated that to have less therapy, because since they figured because therapy became an expense instead of a revenue generator. Okay. But every nursing home prior to that had said, especially if they were accused of providing too much therapy, it always said, no, this is medically necessary. So all you've got to do is look at how much therapy skilled patients were getting before 2018 per diagnosis and how much they're getting now. And you can hold anyway, but that's really kind of on the skilled side of things. But the point is that there are a lot fewer therapists working in nursing homes since then, because there was the financial incentive to do more therapy essentially went away.
Thanks for that. We're going to do just one more question from the Q&A here. This one is from Dean Lerner. Hi, Dean. Thanks for joining us. Dean says, the associations are funded annually by tens of millions of taxpayer dollars, known as membership dues, allowable expense on the facility cost reports. How much harm do you believe these associations have caused residents? Are there any efforts to eliminate this horrible use of taxpayer dollars?
So you're talking about, I'll jump in on this one. I'll jump in on this one. So obviously, very concerning to the extent that there's cost report fraud, to the extent that, there's associations, whether they be transparent and clear who the owners are, but cost reports, which are creating, management fees, which are not real, which are sucking money out of the corporations, it's a huge problem. And so, what we do is take a look at ownership. We take a look at cost reports, and if a case merits further action, then we take it. So I think that it is critical, because if what you end up happening, to everything we've talked about today, if the focus is on creating greater management fees and greater profit, and not on taking care of residents in the appropriate way vis-a-vis staffing, et cetera, then you're creating a poor quality situation, and much money that was intended to go into the support of nursing homes and direct care is not going where it needs to be. So I think, to answer Jean's question, I mean, there are certainly causes of action that one can consider with cost report fraud. And the department has certainly moved forward on some of those cases in the nursing home, home health, and other contexts.
And I think, to build on what Susan was saying, I mean, that's one of the very reasons why we need so much better transparency in terms of how money is being spent, better auditing of how money is being spent, and then accountability for that. I think, we talk about transparency and accountability in order to ensure not only that hopefully residents get the care that they need, but that the dollars are being spent in a way that provides the best opportunity to have as much staffing as is necessary, and that money is being put towards direct care expenses. And so, when we talk about it, we don't only mean transparency and accountability with respect to, what numbers are put on cost reports or who the owners are, but also, is enough money being put towards direct care, or is the amount that's being put towards administration, management, membership dues. What are those percentages? They're, when you look at that, they're very high. And so I think by having a better look at what that money is going towards, really, I think, makes it clearer to consumers, to policymakers, that maybe there need to be changes in what should be allowable expenses versus not allowable expenses, and to have better accountability in that sense, and would get us to better quality care. I don't think, truthfully, we're ever going to get to, you know, fully realizing quality care for every resident until we get a handle on the finances, on how the money is being spent, on the accountability for that. Because there are too, you know, we talked about barriers earlier, there are too many barriers that are inhibiting the good practices that we want to see happening in facilities. And there are too many barriers with respect to money being pulled out of the systems, being pulled out of facilities that are not giving the staff, the administrators that are trying to do a good job, the resources that they need, and actually to actually provide good care, to put the resources and the supplies necessary into those facilities and make sure that the residents are getting what they need. So, you know, we've got to have that if we're going to be moving the needle on care issues.
I just like to add that, you know, as far as the trade associations are concerned, there are always challenges. Even I was president of a physician organization that was really, my professional society, but many physicians really viewed it as their trade association and thought that our primary role should be to maximize physician reimbursement. And that's something that I fought for 20 years. What I would say is within all these associations, I disagree with a lot of their lobbying and their positions on a lot of things, but there are a lot of good people with, you know, who work in nursing homes. You know, I go to nursing homes because many of the people that I love live there and work there. And so these are also places where people of goodwill are trying to get educated and so forth. So what I would say is that if we want to make things better, we have to include all the different stakeholders. And Lori and I, for example, have reached out to various associations over many years to try to find common ground on lots of issues. And parenthetically, when during the Obama administration, when the regulations were sort of updated, I was actually meeting with a chief clinical officer for a national nursing home chain, and she was disseminating an education document produced by the Consumer Voice to all of their nursing homes across the country. So, you know, there is a desire for people to learn. We have to influence that as much as possible. And, you know, in order to do that, we're going to have some dialogue. And as a physician, all I can say is my job, my moral obligation is to love and care for all my patients. It sure helps if I can find some common ground, you know. If we want to do this work and we want to make things better, we have to make it better for everybody. Okay, and that's not defending the indefensible. That's just saying that, you know, we're not going to make things better in spite of everybody. And I'll just tell you, one of the fundamental issues here is in this country, we have a real estate debt financing model for healthcare, for care outside the hospital. That in and of itself is a fundamental problem, and no other country in the world has that. So if we want to address the bigger issues, we really have to address that.
Jonathan, thanks so much. And thank you very much, Jonathan, Susan, Lori, and Amy, for really such an interesting and thoughtful and inspiring panel. Thank you all very much for joining us today. Really appreciate your support and your coming. Thank you. And hope to see you soon. Thanks. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Good night.